Good morning. I just want to level with you. I don't like being here right now, at least for the reason that we're meeting. Mark was my friend. And sometimes you get phone calls and it doesn't set you back that much, but this one did. We all love Mark or we wouldn't be here today. And we celebrate something that he's lived for all of his life. We just don't like the timing that calls us to celebrate today. You all have been there before with different ones, with Mom, Martha, just a few months ago, and now with Mark. I've been reading quite a bit in the book of Job, quite fitting for the times that we're in these days. And boy, when Job hears of all of these losses, he's very filled with grief, but yet he says these wonderful words, "The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away, blessed be the name of the Lord." And I believe he really meant it. It wasn't just something he said. It was something he felt. It was not some scripture that he recited. It was what he felt in his heart and in his soul. And somehow in the midst of our grief, we need to say, "The Lord gives, and aren't you thankful for what he gives us? The Lord taketh away, and aren't you grateful for the fact that we don't have to understand the why behind that?" But here's what we're to do. In all things, oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. We're here for three reasons. The first reason is to celebrate Mark's life, and he lived a good one. We're going to celebrate some of the things that he did, some of his accomplishments, and we're going to have to say goodbye, and that's the hardest thing that we will have to do here today, that a funeral service like this brings closure, and we're going to have to say goodbye to him, and then we're going to consider our own lives in response to the choices that Mark made. As a great example, we're going to consider our life and what we need to be doing. And before we move into that, let's bow our heads and pray, and then we're going to sing some congregational songs together. Christ Jesus, how we love you. Sometimes our actions don't prove it, and we're very sorry for that. I pray a prayer of thanksgiving for how you have blessed Mark with a good life. I praise you and thank you for his faithfulness that you afforded him to live. I'm grateful, Lord, that you have him now. Even though selfishly, I wish it wouldn't have had to happen so soon. So we pray that you will bless these who gather, family, extended family, and friends. I pray that this will be a very meaningful time that will help us through a time of grief and transition. And we pray it in your sweet, wonderful name through Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hey, come and lead us now.
We're going to sing the first verse of Just a Closer Walk. Because he lives.
Because he lives.
music, and we'll be reminded of some of his connections to music in just a moment. Mark B. Hoagland was born on April the 9th, 1954. First house, and pretty much the only house, well, for a while anyway, on Sunset. Melissa said they used to joke with him a lot because just before he was born, Mama had moved in to Sunset House there and was hanging curtains and slipped and fell down the steps, and that's the reason he was the way he was. And I don't know if that's true or not, but she fell down the steps, that was true. He was the fourth of five children, plus David Michael. They always want to include David Michael, who was adopted as a teenager into the family. And they have loved and treasured him all these years. They said there are kind of two sets of kids, two groupings. They called Doug and Russ the big kids for obvious reasons. They were older. And then John, Mark, Melissa, and David Michael were the little kids. You know, as you get older, it just kind of mixes like my family, the six of us together, where we might be 20 years apart, but we all look about the same age. He, in his childhood, it was a great childhood. You guys traveled around a lot, mom and dad being in ministry, different houses. He even called one of their moves, moved to the mission field, moved to another land. It was called Indiana, and served there. He had his hand as a child as a barber, a pharmacist, and a magician. Did you know that? Yeah, he was a barber where he really thought, I think I'm going to cut my sister's hair. And she'd never had a haircut before. And she got a haircut. Wasn't it above your ears? Yeah, beautiful, beautiful haircut. And Mama came home from the PTA meeting very excited when she saw Melissa's beautiful hair on the floor. That was his stint in being a barber. He was a pharmacist too. This wasn't quite as funny. They were doing something, and Mom had the aspirin out, and it was baby aspirin, two different bottles of baby aspirin, and he fed his sister. I'm thinking maybe she had more because stomach had to be pumped. And well, that was all of his stint of being a pharmacist as a kid. And then he was a magician too. He lodged a marble in his throat, and not sure quite if that was part of his magic act routine, but the doctor couldn't find it. And because the doctor wouldn't find it, Dad said, I'm not going to pay you. If you can't find it, you're not going to get any money for that. Got home, and Mark found it. He choked it up and spit it out. So, yeah, that was his professional career as a child, a barber, pharmacist, and a magician. He attended school right here in Springfield, and he loved choir. He loved band, jazz band, concert band, all of those things. He was involved in some of the school musicals. They did West Side Story and Oklahoma, and he had acting parts in that. He just loved theater. Again, he was a preacher's kid. He's always in church, active with his youth group, loved bebopping around in a skating rink there in Fairborn, and all the churches would come together, those own churches, and attend that. And I remember similar days like that myself. He enjoyed family vacations. Many times you would go and visit family in Colorado Springs, and your aunt and uncle would be there, You got to go to Pikes Peak. As a matter of fact, Mark passed out on Pikes Peak. Evidently, he couldn't handle the lighter air. And everyone else was fine, but for some reason, he passed out. You gone to New Mexico visiting family as well. You enjoyed camping trips, going to camp meeting as well. There's so many camp meetings that your father being in ministry that you all attended. He went to college. He attended Mount Vernon Nazarene University, and he had different jobs throughout his life, and food service and factories. He was a truck driver for R&L, I believe it was, and he was definitely a PK. He loved going where his family was. He loved being with Mom and Dad and traveling with them, and loved his father's preaching. And I got to taste just a little bit of the Erie Avenue Church that that both Martha and Dave just took care of so many years. Even after the church was closed, you guys would go and have Christmas Eve services, candlelight services in that facility. How many of you were ever a part of one of those? Yeah. I just heard such wonderful, warm stories of how you guys would enjoy that together. And Mark just loved that. He loved family. He loved being with his family and his extended family. Of course, Mark was shy and never talked, right? And he was quite the talker. You talk about some of the things that he would do, and he was the family, well, Melissa called him the family legalist. The things that you would do at the dinner table, the whole family would gather, as was custom, then still was custom in my house, although there's only three of us, if we sit at the table and gather and we catch up with each other. And that's what you guys would do. But when Mark was there, discussion time really got very detailed. As a matter of fact, he was very detailed with current events, and he'd go and grab the encyclopedia. We have a thing like this called a cell phone that's our encyclopedia now. We just Google it. Mark would go and get the whole volume, full volume set of encyclopedias to prove his point. He was a very intelligent guy. He really was. That chair that's sitting over there, only one person has sat in that chair since Mark did. Mark was our live stream cameraman. We have a pre and post live meeting that goes on prior to the service and after, and Mark always took care of that. And Christmas Eve service, and I believe the Sunday after Christmas, he was on duty. And what would happen, I used to keep the camera in my office, and he would come in, and that would afford us about 10 minutes each Sunday to talk. And boy, was he knowledgeable. Where I would think I would have a handle on the Ohio State Buckeyes, he knew everybody and everything about them. And I'm thinking he knew what shoe size they had. I don't know. But he would just go on and on and on. There have been times, I've got to be honest, where I was wanting to be with Jesus, and Mark came in, and God reminded me that it was just more than okay. That Mark, maybe Mark needed to talk with his pastor and his friend, and I really treasure those times. He loved being with family, loved celebrating holidays. He loved his family. He married Jody on October 30th, 1994. They had two wonderful, beautiful children together, Andrew and Rebecca. And you know, Jody and Mark parted their ways, but continued to stay tight as a family unit to make sure that those kids were cared for. They went on trips together to Disney, two different Make-A-Wish trips to Disney World back in 08 and 2011. He loved his kids. He loved the family tradition of going to the Columbus Zoo with his kids. Or not the Columbus Zoo, the Toledo Zoo, to look at the lights at Christmas time. In talking about memories, of course, Melissa shared a lot about his legalistic play by the rules. Every game had rules, and you need to live by those rules. Don't make up your own rules. You're going to do it the way the book says you do it. He loved his niece, Bethany. He loved going to spending time with her and going to the air shows, the Dayton air shows, and to lunch together, just spending time with grandma, with mom as well, especially on Sundays. That was just a common practice. He loved playing with the family, cornhole and Uno and all of those things. And the one thing that was probably a high point, being with some of the family, some of you getting to go on that cruise with you last year, just before mom passed away, you guys went on this wonderful cruise. First time he'd ever gone on that. I would have loved to have watched him when he looked and experienced all of those things. He went to Dominican Republic and Caicos. And what a great memory, no doubt, you all have in sharing that with both mom and with Mark. Well, these are just, I mean, this 50 plus years of life, 54 years, 56 years of life, and these 10 minutes that I've just shared reflections, this doesn't seem to do it justice. But Mark was a simple guy, lived a simple life, loved people, loved knowledge, loved useless information. If he talked about it, it was true. Let me tell you, no fake news in Mark. He knew the truth about just about anything and everything that he invested in. He knew the truth about Jesus Christ. He got it. It wasn't just something he was raised to do. But his parents taught him right. They pointed the way. And he was able to decipher and make decisions on his own that were no longer mom and dad's commands. He was kind of like me probably when I was young. My brother Mike and I had a choice. My father would say, "Boys, you have a choice to make today on a Sunday morning. Either go to church or tell me you want to stay home and get a whooping and go anyway." And you know, my brother chose number two often. I don't know what that was about, but you know, somehow we've both become pastors. And I think it's the same for Mark. There might be some things he might have did not wanted to do as he was a kid growing up. But you know, something clicked. Something clicked within him. And going to church was not a chore. It was a privilege. And he was such an important part of this church family. And we treasure him and what he's contributed here. We're going to sing a couple more songs now. And then have a special song before I move into the closing message.
We're going to sing the first verse of "How Great Thou Art." First verse of "What a Day That Will Be."
Thank you.
you go right ahead.
I'm going to read Uncle Mark's life verse. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous, do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is wherever you go. Joshua 1:9. Good. Thank you so
much. Yeah. So Moses had died, and what a great life verse this is, by the way. Moses had died, and now Joshua is being led by God. And he's given those strong words that somehow resonated with Mark and he grabbed hold of, and that was his life verse. I have a life verse. Do you? My life verse, I memorized it, King James. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusts in thee, Isaiah 26:3. And that's meaningful. Because the only way that I will keep peace in my life is if my mind is on Him and I'm trusting in Him, I know that I'm going to be okay. Well, this encouraged Mark, the passage that Bethany just read, the verse that Bethany read. And I love the first part of the verse. I'm glad she included it. Have I not commanded you? Have I not commanded you? In other words, please remember all of my commandments. Remember how important my word is to you. Remember how important it is to really follow me, to trust me, to invest in me. Haven't I commanded you? And then he breaks it down to do something very special. The instructions that he was given were too big for him. The things that he was called to do as a leader was bigger than he could handle on his own. Have you been there before? Have you been there to where you just knew that outside of Jesus Christ, you couldn't do it? You couldn't make it. I've got a feeling Mark experienced that a lot in his life. There are a lot of painful things that he dealt with. His sickness, for one, was very challenging. And we almost lost him just not too long ago. He was going through all those diabetes issues. But he trusted Jesus every step of the way. He reminded me of that when we would talk. There would be times he'd be discouraged. He was one of those matter-of-fact guys. He didn't feed into his emotions that much. He would just tell you and state what he's dealing with. And I appreciated that about him. But I do know this life verse was something he held on to. He understood that being strong and courageous was all about trusting Jesus. Being strong and courageous was all about his dependence on Almighty God. Do not tremble, do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. That means going across the Jordan River into Jericho, the promised land that had been promised to them. Outside of Jesus Christ, there's no way they could have obtained that promised land. Outside of God, there would be no way outside of the power of God. And you and I understand that. Here's some things that I think about when I read this passage. First of all, Joshua was to saturate himself in the Word of God. So are you, by the way. Our lives should be all about making a choice to saturate ourselves in God, His Word, His commands, and grab hold of His Word and let it give you life and strength and wisdom, substance, direction, because this world really can mess with you if you don't surrender to God. You say, meditate on my promises. Meditate on them. Have I not commanded you? Have you not heard? Have you forgotten? Please, you need to meditate on my promises. He's saying, trust in the truth of my word for you and follow my demands for you where you should go. And I'm thinking God kicks in his power and nothing is impossible with God. We've got to do the same. I think of investing in the word of God. And I love Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, which simply says, well, let me just back up a couple of verses. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. You shall love the Lord with your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. I love that. I love the way it's broken down. All your heart, all your soul, all your might. You know, your heart is kind of the seat of your emotion. I'm thankful in the United States that is the seat of our emotion, the heart, because I shouldn't say this, but I'm going to anyway. There's some countries that the seat of the emotion is the bowel. Wouldn't that mess up some love songs, huh? And I won't go into singing any of those. That would just be weird. But the seat of the emotion is the heart. And he's saying, with all of your emotions, invest in loving me. Love me. Love me with all your heart. And then I love the thought of loving the Lord my God with all of my soul. You know what your soul is? I remember talking about this at Martha's funeral. Probably mentioned it at Dave's funeral. The not only the seat of the emotion is the heart, but that real me is my soul. Now this body, thank God, someday I will shed. It just doesn't cooperate as much as it used to. This definitely, as I was talking to our funeral director this morning before the service, this doesn't cooperate a lot more than it used to not cooperate. And boy, it's just weird. I forget so much more than I know, you know? But we are called to invest in the real me, the real you. It's your soul. You will never get, thank God I will get rid of this body someday. But I will never get rid of the real me, because that lasts forever and ever and ever. And I want my soul to be so invested in loving the Lord my God. Mark understood that. I'm thinking he loved the Lord his God quite well. And then with all of his might, all of your strength, all of your energy, all of your physical effort that you can give, doesn't that make so much sense? So we're emotionally connected with God. We're emotionally involved in investing, in loving him with all of our emotion, all of our heart. We must be invested in all of our soul, the real me. Every bit of me, I must invest, because that's the only thing that's going to last forever. And then with all of my might, this physical body, and whatever will cooperate, I'm going to invest it wholly, solely in him, in loving him. And if I love him, I'm going to do what he says. When I love him, even if I don't understand, I'm still going to obey. I'm going to be invested with all of my energy, all of my might, all that I've got. I'm going to be invested in following God and saturating myself in his word, so that I will know and understand the direction of his love for me. Doesn't that make sense? Isn't it good? Isn't it rich? So in doing that, I think his life verse really comes into play. Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble and be dismayed, for the Lord your God, I'm going to be with you wherever you go. Won't you take that home with you today? Why don't you understand and be reminded? Let the Holy Spirit remind you as you invest in him with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your might. May you find sweet peace, comfort, and joy as he gives you exactly what you need wherever you go. Okay? We're going to bow our heads and pray. And we're going to close then, and you're going to have a time of coming forward in just a moment. And then we're going to travel to the cemetery and say our final goodbye and pray over Mark. And then we're going to come back here for a special time of fellowship. And you know what? You know how Christians spell love, don't you? F-O-O-D. And you're going to have a good time of fellowshipping and eating together. Let's bow our heads. Jesus, we really do need you in times like this. I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for how good you've been to Mark, to his children, to his family. I've just got a feeling that they're going to need you more than ever and being forced to say goodbye to him. And I know it won't have to be forever. If they make that commitment to submit their lives to you and trust you, there will be a day when they'll be reunited with him and even better with you. May it be so. Bless us now as we travel on to the cemetery. Bless these precious family members. Give them encouragement. I pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.